Welcome to the Cognitive Crucible, produced by the Information Professionals Association. Our website is information-professionals.org, where you can find links and information about today's conversation and get access to members-only content. Join John Bicknell and explore all aspects of our generational challenge, cognitive security. The Cognitive Crucible is a forum that presents different perspectives and emerging thought leadership related to the information environment. The opinions expressed by guests are their own and do not necessarily reflect the views of or endorsement by the Information Professionals Association.
My guest today on the Cognitive Crucible is Captain Jose Davis, who is a public affairs officer for headquarters, U.S. Air Forces in Europe and Air Forces Africa at Ramstein Air Base, Germany. He has over 14 years of experience in integrated communications, both in the public and private sectors. This summer, he'll be heading over to NATO Allied Air Command's J-10 Directorate Strategic Communications. Jose Davis, welcome to the Cognitive Crucible.
Howdy, John. I'm glad to be here. Really love the show, and I love all the speakers you have here and their thought leadership. So thank you for the opportunity.
You bet. Looking forward to it as well. And our audience, you might have heard Jose say howdy. Jose and I were chatting before we hit record. We're both from Texas. Jose from the San Antonio area, and I'm from the Houston, Texas. And also to our audience, more importantly than what I just said, it's important to know that Jose's opinions are his own and do not represent the opinions or policies of any U.S. government agency or NATO for that matter. So the conversation I'd like to have with you today, Jose, will cover a recent paper of yours entitled Leveraging AI for Operations in the Information Environment, with the subtitle Three Demonstrations in Disinformation, Social Media, and Entropy, which focuses on the application of AI in the realm of OIE, of operations in the information environment. But before we get into this topic, could we start by getting your assessment on the current state of the U.S. Air Force's strategy on operations in the information environment?
Yeah, so I think in layman's terms, operations in the information environment is defined just as on how information is communicated, transmitted, and processed in today's very unique information age. Now, in the U.S. Air Force, we formally defined OIE as actions that use information to influence behavior, affect information systems, and impact external actors. Now, this definition is really important. I'm gonna explain why in a couple moments. But I think that, you know, you had Major General Ryder now here on the Cognitive Crucible, and he said it really, really well. He's kind of like a PA idol to all of us PAOs. So whenever I can quote him, I sound smarter. When he was here on the Cognitive Crucible, he said, you know, over the past 20 years, the military has probably become more sophisticated and more attuned to the challenges that exist when conducting operations in the information environment. And I think this is very true. In the early 2010s, we saw how good ISIS was on social media, and we were shocked at how bad we were ourselves in that same space. So you could say that after the Cold War, with the absorption of the U.S. Information Agency and the end of the Reagan-era Active Measures Working Group, you know, our skills in the information environment atrophy. And at one point, the DoD didn't even have an information strategy. So within the Air Force, as a consequence, we had no comprehensive framework in allowing us to have unified efforts in the information environment. And now we do. If you were to ask me, well, what is operations in the information environment like 4 or even 5 years ago, you would have gotten a dozen different definitions. Today, we have a unified definition codified in doctrine. You know, this past fall, the Defense Department published this strategy that they call it the Strategy for Operations in the Information Environment. And it continued to codify terminology and language, all rooted in the seminal joint publication that came out in 2022 for information and joint operations. Within the Air Force, in the past 5 to 6 years, there have been a myriad different activities going on to get our information warfare capabilities in line. In September of 2019, we redesignated the 16th Air Force into a component numbered Air Force, which made it the only Air Force entity at that level that was fully focused in information warfare. And then in 2022, then Chief of Staff of the Air Force, General C.Q. Brown, now Chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, he published this document called Operations in the Information Environment Strategy Plan. And it outlined what we needed to do as a force within the Air Force to establish information warfare capabilities within the next 4 years. And then last year, in 2023, Air Combat Command got designated as the only Air Force major command to prepare, train, and equip operators in the information environment. So this is all to say that there's just been a lot of codification, formalization, and investment by our senior leaders within the U.S. Air Force to get operations in the information environment correct.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah, for sure. No doubt. And Jose mentioned a moment ago, the previous episode we had with General Ryder. And for those interested, we'll have a link to the show notes in the show notes to that episode to check out. Yeah. The Air Force has been busy over the last couple of years, doing some reorgs and publishing policy, which is definitely to be commended. You know, I kind of think of the United States military services as having somewhat of like a federalization construct for operations yeah. in the information environment. You know, just like the United States of America has, you know, 50 states and the 50 states, you have some, you know, constitutional scholars consider, you know, each state is like a laboratory of democracy, right? Not all states have the same laws and, you know, things are tailored or customized according to the will of the citizens of each state. And so it is with the military services. The Army, Navy, Air Force, Marines, and Space Force now too are all, you know, somewhat coordinated, but also somewhat independently according to their different missions, evolving their operations in the information environment policy and doctrine. And they can all be thought of as experiments, and you know, over time we'll be you know kind of favoring things which tend to work better and discarding things which don't work as well, and over time the whole U.S. armed forces I believe will be getting better and better incrementally, but they're experiments too. Do you have any comment on all that?
I think that's a great point to kind of dive into a little bit. I mean, we learned so much within the Air Force. We learned so much from our counterparts. So that kind of federated diversity, if you will, of thought really allows us to learn from each other, because we all thought the same. We'd probably all be making the same mistakes, right? So there is virtue in that diversity of different approaches to operations in the information environment. I mean, for the Air Force, for example, I think we didn't have an information warfare capability for a while. It was really we're talking about MISO and PSYOPs and so forth. That was really an U.S. Army activity. And then that changed when we started looking over to our Army brethren and realizing, you know, this information environment thing is exceptionally complicated and we need to have this capability. Now, that being said, it's good that we've codified our terminology across the services. For example, when I say OIE or operations in the information environment, that is a recent term. In 5 or 6 years ago, people were calling it information warfare, or, you know, they would interchangeably use PSYOPs and information warfare, and, you know, people would get confused. And now we have definitions. There's doctrines defining these things. You know, information warfare is still a thing, but that's an adversary facing activity within, you know, information of operations. Operations in the information environment encompasses everything from public affairs to to our, you know, MISO PSYOP brethren connectivities. So it's a great point, John. I think it goes both ways. Diversity of thought is great, but got to have some uniform way of approaching it.
Yep. Let's start talking a little bit more about your paper, which was an output from your AI accelerator experience at MIT recently. And so your paper is entitled, again, Leveraging AI for Operations in the Information Environment. Why did you choose this topic? And by the way, is this paper publicly available yet?
Not yet. It's slated for publication in the Air and Space Operations Review Journal. So it just recently went through peer review. You know, publications take a while to go through the entire process, but it will hopefully by this summer.
Okay. But, all right. When it's available, please let us know, and we'll put a link in the show notes.
Yes, sir. Yeah. So AI, so the fun stuff. I decided the topic, I think, in two levels. There's like a personal level and professional level. Personally, I've always been kind of a black sheep PAO. Like, I actually love math. I love statistics data. And AI lives and breathes in data. So it just felt, it felt right. And, I'm a sci-fi geek. So I've always been fascinated by AI. But more than that, professionally, everything that's happening in AI is relevant to public affairs and communications writ large. You know, the recent advancements in natural language processing with what we see with ChatGPT and computer vision with DALL-E and Midair. We're talking about, when we talk about those things in AI, we're talking about AI's ability to see, to talk, which are amazing, awesome. Mm-hmm. But I think there's almost like a philosophical component to that. You know, what we're witnessing with AI is how an entity is interacting and communicating on par with a human being. My first impression when I played with ChatGPT, and I'd be shocked if this wasn't most people's first impression, was when I communicate with ChatGPT, it feels like it's really communicating back at me, like another human. And, that's it. An interesting phenomenological experience, and that's for me professionally, as a professional communicator, as a public mm-hmm. affairs officer, mm-hmm. that's very relevant to me, because if we talk about what is the substance of communication, do we consider what ChatGPT and these other foundational large language models like Gemini and whatnot? Is that communicating? Is that really communication? ChatGPT, how it works is essentially it takes word embeddings. It transforms words into these numerical representations in a mathematical vector space. That's very different vis-a-vis how we humans communicate through all these layers of neuropsychological, cognitive, social, cultural, linguistic factors. Mm-hmm. So if you think about it, I think this is the point. Professionally and personally, it all converges. Like when we talk about AI, AI passing the Turing test, or mm-hmm. Even John Searle's famous Chinese room experiment about AI. We're talking about AI demonstrating intelligence, understanding, but it is fundamentally about communication. It's about AI demonstrating intelligence through communication. Now, this is like my idealistic answer of my interest, mm-hmm. And it's genuine. Professionally, I guess practically, I'm interested. I was interested in this topic because AI has just had an immense impact in my industry of public relations and marketing. In November of 2022, for example, before ChatGPT, there were probably around 250 vendors who offered an AI solution. AI isn't something new. It's been around. Now, right, who knows, with generative AI, who knows how many vendors and solutions are out there to do an array of different things, from analytics to classification to content generation, sentiment analysis. So for me, like, AI is impacting me directly in every way. So the topics seemed right. Within the Air Force, when we're talking about operations and the information environment and AI, there's almost another layer there that I wanted to explore, because we're just starting to kind of peel back the implications of generative AI within the security environment, within the defense industry and within our ability to counteract what our adversaries are doing. And I think that's, I think I'll bring it up. I'll bring my answer to end with that. You know, all these capabilities with AI that we are personally experiencing with ChatGPT generation content, et cetera, our adversaries have those same tools. They have the same access to those tools. I guess that's where we're at now. What is that implementation moving forward into the future?
Right. And to your last point there, our enemies of democracy have access to these tools as well. And they have access, or they are developing more sophisticated versions of these tools as we speak. But even the less sophisticated versions have applications which just didn't exist even 4 or 5 years ago, which are, you know, worrisome as well. So it's a big wide open sprawling problem that, you know, just that there's the Western, you know, democracies have a big surface area, attack surface area, which, you know, all these tools can be applied, you know, in a number of ways, which is very worrisome, I would say. So in your paper, you present three different case studies which demonstrate how AI can be positive, can positively impact OIE, and your paper advocates for direct AI research in this area. Do you think you could briefly unpack these three different use cases?
Yeah, I'd love to. This opportunity to be here essentially was the point of my paper. I wanted to use case studies because I wanted to make a case on the importance of leveraging AI in operations in the information environment. You know, the DoD is essentially dumping all this money in AI research and development, but not a lot of it is in operations in the information environment. And that makes sense, right? We have to, in terms of all of these assets that we have, you know, we're probably lower on that priority scale. But I mean, like I brought up in the earlier section, I think we're almost in a dawn of a new age in terms of generative AI's ability to either enhance or corrupt our democracy. And it's a scary thought. I mean, there's research on this already developing in the Rand Institute, for example, or even at NATO, about talking about this, at least theorizing in it, because we're literally at the beginning of it. Now, I adopted in my paper, I wanted to adopt this kind of Euclidean method in forming my arguments. So I began with the definition of OIE, like I did here on the show. Yeah. But then after my definitions, I used sort of these case studies as propositions to lay out my argument. Like, why is this important? So in my first case study, probably the most, it was my first because it's probably the most relevant and to our point talking about generative AI and democracy. The first case study I called Inoculating Against Disinformation, really countering disinformation. The most, I think, apparent example that a lot of people have about, you know, the detriment of disinformation to democracies is what we saw in 2016 when the Russian government propagated that dubious information on social media to try to manipulate the results of the US presidential election. I mean, it's crazy to think that that's child's play compared to what can be done, you know, now, and what is probably being done now as we lead up to the next presidential election. Mm-hmm. But disinformation, I focus specifically on disinformation, not just misinformation as a whole, but disinformation, which is misinformation with a nefarious bent. And I truly think disinformation, if it wasn't, it is now. It's the plague of our information age. And it's just going to get worse with the advancements of generative AI. And again, I'm going to hark back to General Ryder because I pulled these quotes because he says things so well. That's why he's the spokesperson for the entire defense part.
That's right. Just to our audience again. Yeah. General Ryder, if you pay attention to United States national security related news, general writer these days is frequently, quote unquote, at the podium on TV, yeah, discussing military operations and communicating from the podium. So,
yeah.
Anyway,
and,
yeah.
And he's a, a quick sidebar. He's a great human being. Like, he's come out here to Germany several times for our Ukraine contact group, and you see him on the podium. Right? You see him on TV, professional as you can be. You meet him one on one. He's the nicest, most personable person you'll ever meet. You know, he actually makes it a point to go talk to us lowly people, you know, the peasants, you know, to get our thoughts as we, you know, we set up this large event. But full circle, I mean, going back to him, he had a great quote here. And he said, there's many recent examples that you could point to about disinformation and cyber campaigns by either state or non-state actors that have strategic effects that can diminish or in some cases neutralize U.S. strategic advantages or capabilities or even national resources. He's talking about in reference to even before the rapid advancements in generative AI. So imagine what we can expect in the next 5 or 10 years. But what's most disturbing about disinformation is that people who have been exposed to it may continue to even rely on it, even if it's been debunked. That's a little bit kind of mind blowing. And researchers call this phenomenon the continued influence effect. So in my paper, I made this argument that, okay, well, what is the best way to root out disinformation? If you can't mitigate it in certain cases, probably the best thing to do is to preemptively pre-bunk it, to prevent it from taking a hold of people's cognition. And I think the problem now is that it's now even more exceptionally difficult to do that in the information environment with generative AI, when you can just prompt, you know, using natural language, hey, create a photo of President Trump or President Biden or whatnot behind bars, and it will generate this highly realistic image that you can propagate for disinformation purposes. And, you know, I'm obviously not the only one talking about this stuff. I mean, or even thinking about this stuff. There's a lot of people ringing the bell about this concern. And I think this was one of the reasons why back in the fall, President Biden, you know, at least this motivated that executive order in the fall for AI safety, executive order 14110, according to my notes, which established those new AI safety and security standards and ordering all these executive branches that, hey, we need to do something. We need to prevent this kind of AI manipulation. We need to protect the American people from the potential risk of AI systems. Now, in the private industry, we've seen experimentation in trying to mitigate the potential for deep fakes and fake news and disinformation and whatnot with watermarking techniques, specifically with fake images, right? In August of last year, Google's DeepMind developed this technique called SynthID, which embeds changes to individual pixels in images so that watermarks are invisible to the human eye, but they're visible or detectable by computers. You know, I'm not advocating against that approach. I mean, any approach to prevent disinformation is a win. But in my paper, I argued that in terms of information warfare, operations in the information environment, especially in the context of that continued influence effect that I just talked about, watermarking is insufficient to the curtailment of disinformation. So one of the fortunate parts of being able to do this fellowship at MIT was to be exposed to this, to the sheer brain power over there of these super intelligent engineers and these amazing researchers. And I discovered these two approaches that I outlined in my paper that I think fit the bill in terms of inoculating against disinformation in the technical sense. The first technique dubbed PhotoGuard was developed by researchers, a lead researcher, Hadi Salman over there. He's a PhD researcher overseen by Alexander Madry. And I mentioned his name because he's now working for OpenAI. Super nice guy and helped me out a lot in trying to work the coding development of the platform. But he was also one of the lead proponents. He actually had he actually testified to Congress about ringing the bell about disinformation is going to get far worse with generative AI. Mm-hmm. So that team there at MIT developed this technique called PhotoGuard. And what it does is that it makes an image resistant to AI-powered manipulation by adding this carefully crafted imperceptible perturbation or modification to a pixel, similar to what Google's doing with their technique in watermarking. But what this particular pixel does, this modification of the pixel, is that it disrupts the diffusion model or the AI model's ability to generate novel imagery or fake imagery or deep fakes. So the approach leverages what's called adversarial perturbations to immunize images. So it forces, long story short, it forces the AI model to generate images that are unrelated to the originally immunized input image. So then it demonstrates this ability to immunize images at the outset. It prevents the AI model. It would prevent, Dolly or Midjourney, or at least in theory, from creating a fake image or that could, manipulate some election or something in our democracy.
Wow. So is it very, could I just make sure I'm following here? So there is there, like I was saying before, the attack surface for what's coming online with AI and what already exists with AI is enormous. And one of the attack surfaces is like feeding into algorithms tainted data. That is, one way of screwing up decision making, right? If you feed people false information or algorithms false information, then the algorithm is processing and ultimately decisions potentially are being made with faulty information to begin with. And what you were just describing using, what did you call it?
Perturbation.
Yeah.
I
just looked up a couple of studies. I'll drop them into the show notes. But this adversarial perturbation sounds like it's similar-ish, except it is pushing tainted information into generative AI imagery and video algorithms, maybe. Do you think
that's spot on? And that's such a cool parallel that I didn't even think about that. In a way, the way you put it is perfect. In a way, you're feeding the AI model disinformation to prevent it from creating disinformation. By corrupting the data or a pixel. We're not really. We're not talking about like a wide corruption of the data set, but a little, because you have to think of pixel as the data that the AI model feeds on to be able to do its thing.
Right.
And if you just do one little modification, one little virus, right, it then corrupts the entire AI model's ability to generate deepfakes.
Right.
That's a beautiful parallel.
Right. And so these perturbations are deliberately coded, but they don't tend to affect the users or the consumer's perception of the image. It still looks like an image of whatever your subject matter is. But at the pixel level, there are these little taintings which confound present day generative AI algorithms or something like that.
Well, let me clarify that part. So from the perspective of the user or the receiver looking at the output from the AI model that got fed the corrupted data, right?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
The output is an unrealistic image. So the receiver, the individual, the person is looking at an image that is not real. It can't be real because it looks like a caricature or it just looks fake. I think that's the problem with generative AI moving forward in the next couple of years is A, that you can produce it at scale now with AI, but B, that it's high fidelity. You can't delineate between real photos and then what an AI creates. You could have done that probably, a human being could have probably done, not probably, but for sure could have delineated an AI output from a human output 4 years ago, 3 years ago. Mm-hmm. Today, it's nearly impossible. So the idea that PhotoGuard proposes if someone is going to try to create deepfakes or disinformation, and we can't prevent them from doing it, short of, you know, like unplugging their computer or whatever, then let's force the AI model to create fake images so the human being who is receiving or consuming this content knows that there's no way this can be real, right? This. So, I mean, yeah. I think a good example, I guess, in a way, would be like, you know, you feed the perturbation into an image or into the data set, right? And then if, let's say, some nefarious user says, I generate a picture of President Trump behind bars, right? I'm sorry, I just keep using that example because I saw recent literature about that. But what happens is the output is, because it's corrupted, the data set is corrupted with that little perturbation, is maybe President Trump like super orange or something, or like missing a leg or missing an arm or whatnot. So it prevents high fidelity images from being produced and deceiving the receiver.
That's the virtue of that approach. Yeah. No, that's awesome. It just goes to show you this cat and mouse isn't the right word, but it's arms race. Thing where, you know, techniques are being developed to, mitigate risk. And then there'll probably be ways around it, in the future. And so it goes. Well, that's an awesome use case for sure.
If I could quote real quick, NATO publishes this thing called NATO Virtual Manipulation Report, and they put it really well to the point that you're bringing up right now. In the current stage of where we're at, it stated, it remains unclear right now whether in the long run, if the defenders or attackers will derive greater benefit from AI systems. In a way, it is a cat and mouse game. You know, like we're not sure right now whether AI is going to be super great in the long run for democracy or super bad for democracy.
Right. For sure. Okay. Awesome. Can you continue on with your paper?
Oh, yeah. Let me. So then there was one other technique I got to explore there when I was at MIT. And it was such a great privilege to be able to go there. One of the virtues of MIT is that they really take seriously the interdisciplinary model of converging all these thoughts, technical, social, political, and whatnot. And I bring this up because I got the fortune to attend what they called a disinformation day there at MIT, hosted by the media lab there. And there I learned about these researchers, these engineers developing something along the lines of PhotoGuard, but different, specific to video deepfakes. And so what these researchers at MIT proposed is using what they call a semi-supervised artifact attention model. And what this model does is it simply just amplifies artifacts in deepfake videos to make them more detectable by people. Now, what artifacts are in computer vision, they are distortions or unwanted features introduced into a video during processing, or in the case of my paper, during the processing of manipulation. So artifacts and deepfakes can vary depending on the technology. And you can see this, you know, in simple manipulations. When someone tries to change the frame rate, it will create inconsistencies. And then you obviously know that the video has altered in some way. When that happens, you'll see that that it would cause stuttering or unnatural movements of whoever is depicted in that video. So these researchers are essentially saying, well, let's leverage that. Let's leverage anomalies to detect deepfakes by amplifying them. So the researchers call their technique carrying it. And what it does is it leverages this inherent vulnerability in artifacts and deepfakes. In every video deepfake, there is always an artifact because you're always trying to manipulate the original source data or the source content. So in CarryNet, the idea is you generate these deepfake caricatures by amplifying the natural manipulation that isn't in a deepfake. So then it allows, it magnifies these unnatural movements or unnatural manipulations caused by these artifacts. So a human eye can obviously see, you know, oh, this is fake. This is not, you know, this can't be real. And this is important because, like I said earlier, as we go further into this new age of generative AI, it's becoming increasingly more difficult to separate the real from the AI generated.
Yeah, for sure. And also, what was the word that you used a couple of times? CarryNet?
CarryNet, yeah. So short for caricature and then network. So CarryNet.
Oh, okay. I was just trying to look up a study on it or something along those lines. So, okay, cool.
Yeah, so this was another really cool thing about this MIT fellowship is that this technique, I got the privilege of getting their paper that they were going to present at the conference, their pre-publication, and I got permission to publish it in my own research. Point being is their research is so new that it's not there yet. It's not out there yet, you know. And I got the ability to have access to it. I think they're actually presenting it to a conference to computer engineers this month in April. So you should see it next month somewhere
yeah. Okay.
On,
yeah,
on Google
yeah.
Scholar.
Cool. But, awesome.
Yeah, but I, one last thing I want to talk about carrying it because I think this was the most fascinating thing when they were doing the research. They not only did, you know, like for engineers, and I'm not going to pretend like I understand it, but engineers, they have to quantify all their, you know, all their stuff and studies. Well, they also did a little bit of, they did a little social experiments of their model. They put people in front of, you know, videos and asked them, hey, is this a deep fake video or is this, you know, is this real? And then they obviously, you know, asked them with deep fake videos that went through CarryNet. And what they discovered was that in these social experiments, that exposing deep fakes by amplifying these artifacts increases detection by people of disinformation more than text labeled warnings that it is a deep fake. So I thought that was super fascinating because it goes to show, you know, perceptively, what's impressed on the mind are things that are sensational, right? Things that just stand out because you'll see an output of a CarryNet deep fake and you're like, well, this is crazy fake. This is not real. There's no way, you know, this could be real. And somehow that impresses on the mind more prevalently than if you had like a label underneath saying this is a fake generated video deepfake.
That's interesting. I wonder if there's any relation there with I'm not sure whether cigarette companies still do this or whether they're mandated to do it, but once upon a time so there's warning labels on tobacco products, you know,
right.
Warning, this product is bad for you. It's, you know, can cause cancer and these, this, that, and the other, but, they once were mandated to actually have like gruesome images, which accompanied these warnings, which tried, I guess, to make it even clearer. this is what can potentially happen to you. So CarryNet sounds like it has a similar effect on, communicating to people. Here's what's possible.
Oh, you're absolutely right, John. I mean, they actually have those here in Germany. So you go to a local Aldi and you go to the cigarette section and they have all these gruesome photos on the labels of these cigarettes. And, you know, like I remember when I first walked into the Aldi and I saw my attention immediately veered to that. And I'm like covering my kid's eyes, you know, I'm like, yeah, but it goes to show because I never thought about cigarettes in the States because text labeled, you know, hey, this is carcinogenic or whatever, you know. Never thought twice to look that way. But when you have this kind of sensory stimuli, it impresses on the brain more than text. But that's a great analogy. That's definitely exactly what they're aiming at.
Yeah, for sure. Okay. What else in your paper would you like to call out?
Yeah, let me continue on the disinformation part, because I think it's the most important case study, and I think most relevant to people who are on the cognitive crucible. I talked about the technical aspects of preventing disinformation, what some great engineers are thinking up. But there's also a social component that I tried to couple in my paper, and that's inoculation of disinformation in the psychological sense. And this was pioneered in the 1960s in a framework called Inoculation Theory, advanced by social researcher William McGuire. So the idea in the social sciences is that rather than bombarding people with supportive facts, another approach that might be more effective in different contexts is to expose people to a weakened dose of specific persuasive or manipulative content, which will then confer, just like in a vaccine, a medical vaccine, psychological resistance against future, more malignant manipulative attacks. The analogy is clear there. It's a medical vaccine kind of thing, right? And there's this great researcher out here in Europe. He's over at the University of Cambridge, Dr. Sander van der Linden. And he's done amazing research in this field and actually tested inoculation theory within the context of online misinformation. In his studies in 2017, he showed that both partial and full inoculation are effective at countering the effects of misinformation exposure. And I think an easier example to show the positive effect of inoculation like this in the information environment is what we saw in the geopolitical stage in 2021. Leading up to the invasion of Ukraine, the Biden administration was just releasing a whole bunch of information of what probably, what was classified information into the public sphere to set the stage, saying, this is what the Russians are doing. The Russians are building up. The Russians are going to invade. And in a sense, preparing people, inoculating people for what was to come, which did come, in 2022. And that was the invasion of Ukraine. Yeah. So then when that happened, we weren't, the general public or certain publics weren't as susceptible to the Russians' disinformation campaign that followed from the invasion. Now, the virtue of this inoculation pre-bunking approach is that it also forces the exercise of individuals' rational faculties, which will then allow them to resist this disinformation more freely in their own time, very much like the body's immune system. I think practically we're talking about, like in the day-to-day situation, if someone tells me you're wrong, I'm not going to be as susceptible. I'm not going to listen to them. Right. But if I'm given the freedom or the freedom to use my own rational faculties to come to my own conclusion, then I'm more likely to do what you want me to do. I mean, anyone who has kids probably knows this, right? You tell a kid not to do that, they go out and go do it. But if you try to mentor the kid and let them exercise their own free will, then they're more likely to do it. And that's essentially the idea of pre-bunking or inoculation. At MIT, there's this great researcher called Dr. David Rand. And he works over at the MIT Sloan School of Management, and he has done great research in this field of people using enabling people to use their own rational faculties to rationally deliberate and encourage people to think through information instead of being forced information down their throat. Yeah, so I think to couple all this together, my thoughts are going all over the place, but together, my paper proposes this inoculation or this preventative method, both on the technical side with those two approaches, photo guard and carrying it, and then even on the social side to allow people to exercise their own rational faculties using inoculation theory as a means to prevent their exposure to disinformation. And in my paper, from the perspective of the Defense Department, we have this platform called the Defense Visual Information Distribution Service, or DVIDS. And it's run by the Defense Media Activity, what we call DMA here. Mm-hmm. They run this platform. And the thing with the platform is it's a great source to get, you know, publicly available broadcast quality videos, still images, just every piece of content that DOD produces that's publicly releasable goes on the platform. The scary thing about this is that it's publicly accessible to anyone who can create an account. So you can imagine nefarious users, hey, I got this access to all this data that I can then run through a generative AI model to create manipulative content of, hey, let's say a Marine, you know, shooting a civilian, right? And so my proposal in my paper and case study is you need to inoculate your images. Every image that's uploaded on this platform that's publicly accessible, you add a little perturbation to it to prevent anyone from trying to manipulate the content. And that's the sum of my first case study.
Wow. That's awesome stuff, man. Well, that's just one of three. So
I'll skip the second one.
Well, please mention it at least. Just a quick hit on it.
So I think the biggest thing I'm going to say about my second one, which was titled Automating Social Media Analysis, is that it's amazing how innovative U.S. Air Force airmen can be in solving problems with available resources like ChatGPT. So that particular case study focused on large language models using ChatGPT how it can help us overcome, you know, certain barriers that we may have within the context of the information environment. And specifically, we're doing social media analysis using ChatGPT to help us do social media analysis for the evaluation or the assessment of the information environment, which I think is going to be a great lead to my third case study. Because I think Kara, Major Kara Masick here, who was here on the Cognitive Crucible, she had a great discussion about just how hard it is to assess the information environment. And she had this great paper recently that was published by the Air University back in December, advocating for the use of large language models in operations in the information environment. Outstanding paper. And I would recommend that in the source notes. I really loved her. Loved her episode here on the Cognitive Crucible. Quick sidebar, you know, like her talk about rhetoric and, you know, how it has the ability to heal the soul. You know, I'm a philosopher, you know, so I was eating that stuff up. You know, Aristotle's my boy. So I loved her talk here. And I talk about her because her talk is relevant to my third case study. And that is the assessing the information environment. My third case study was called Entropy, Information and Assessments. And it was the idea in sum of using entropy or uncertainty as a metric to assess the information environment. And I do want to say, and I genuinely mean this, John, I really respect and admire your thought leadership in this space. And I really look up to what you say about this stuff. And so I hope you let me be a bit of a fanboy in this third case study, because if my first case study on disinformation was my most serious section, my third case study was the most fun I had writing, because I got to talk about Claude Shannon, right? I got to explore his thought. And, you know, Shannon is one of my intellectual heroes. Not just because he was a mathematical and, engineering genius, but also because I think he was just simply a hardworking, decent dude. He had these kind of virtues of this unassuming Midwestern guy. And I love the Midwest. I mean, I'm from Texas. I love Texas. But if I had a choice, I'd rather live in the Midwest, to be honest. Ethos of that part of the country. And my wife is from Iowa. So, I mean, I think any part of the country that produces people like my wife and Claude Shannon must be must be the best part of America. But anyway.
Yeah. Yeah, so, I don't want to get ahead of things too much. But one of the books that you're wanting to recommend is a book I think that's more of like a biography or a of Claude Shannon. Yeah, really interesting fellow. So definitely recommend that.
Yes. Yeah. I'll leave all the fanfare for Claude Shannon for the biography. I recommend the read. It's great. And walking around MIT, because Claude Shannon was a professor there at MIT towards the latter part of his life, that was a really great honor to know that I was walking in the same area of the campus as Dr. Shannon. But anyway, so going to the case study, third case study, and like I said, Kara had a great talk here about assessing the information environment. So I won't belabor that point, that part. What I will say, as you know, a person who's done PR and marketing, not just in the government, but also in the private sector, the metrics that are used in the private sector, you know, whether it's customer lifetime value or even sentiment analysis, right? These are, I think, are insufficient for being able to measure effectiveness or measures of performance, measure effectiveness of what we call here in doctrine, within a national security context. We need special metrics for assessing the information environment, which in my paper, I argue AI has the ability to ameliorate, to improve. So Shannon's innovation, Claude Shannon's innovation was in conjoining entropy with information. So working at Bell Labs in the 1940s, Bell Labs, which was funded by a telecommunications company, he was a communications engineer, and he was keenly interested in how to engineer a communication system that could effectively transmit a message through a medium despite noise and other obfuscations. As a PA, as a strategic communicator, that's the same interest I have, essentially. How do I communicate a message effectively despite noise in the information environment? And Shannon, the cool thing about Shannon was that he used some rigorous mathematics to develop this classic model of communication, which was later developed in the social sciences and in communication studies by the likes of Wilbur Schramm and Harold Laswell. Now, an interesting side note about Wilbur Schramm, he's the father of the University of Iowa's acclaimed writer's workshop. Well, he was responsible for making sure that Shannon's work got published, and because he recognized just the groundbreaking material that Shannon was putting out there. So in a way, if it wasn't for Schramm, you know, in the social sciences, in the communication studies, who knows what we would have gotten out of the mathematical theory of communication from Claude Shannon. But
just also another quick sidebar on Iowa. In a prior life, I also worked at ACT, the assessment company, which is headquartered in Iowa City, Iowa. But the reason the reason why it's headquartered there is because at the University of Iowa in the 1930s or maybe the 1940s, that was some of the early research that ultimately became like OCR, optical character recognition software. And that is some of the foundational software that goes into testing and assessment and, you know, scaling, you know, mass scaling, all this stuff. So the University of Iowa has, you know, a long history of technological thought leadership in this whole AI space, but
For sure, that's an interesting point. I think, you know, you wouldn't guess it because it's in a way a liberal arts college. I mean, University of Iowa with the writer's workshop. But I remember reading that. I mean, I was going to give this a book recommendation, but long story short, there was a computer engineer there that was, you know, a professor there at the University of Iowa. I forget his name. Can't remember for the life of me. But if it wasn't for him, we wouldn't have our modern computers, I think is the point. Either University of Iowa, University of, or Iowa State, but forgive me, I don't remember.
That's all right, yeah.
Yeah, anyway, it's interesting this confluence, I think, is my point, between the social sciences and the technical side, the engineering side. And I think that's the theme, the underlying theme of my entire paper that I tried to stress, because I am in the social sciences in a way. You know, everyone, there's an expectation that we in public affairs or people, professional communicators, that we have to act like behavioral scientists in a certain way, right? If we want to effectively communicate a message. So I really wanted to stress that part in my paper. But anyway, going back to Claude Shannon's mathematical model of communication, in that model spawned this idea of entropy, of information as entropy, as bits, you know. And entropy as a concept is really fascinating. I mean, it's the idea of measuring disorder or randomness or uncertainty in a system, typically indicating a move from order to disorder. So in terms of communication or information, Shannon realized that information could be decoupled from the semantics of a message. So once isolated, one could measure information or entropy within that channel. So for, I think in layman's terms or in simpler terms, is that the higher the entropy, the higher the uncertainty, the more difficult it is to get the message across that channel, which might force redundancy. But the lower the entropy, the better the message can get across that channel. So as a PA, as a public affairs officer, I'm looking usually to minimize entropy so I can effectively communicate to my audience without redundancy or with limited redundancy, because otherwise the information makes the message almost ineffective. Mm-hmm. So in sum, I think this last case study, I just wanted to talk about entropy. I really just want to talk about Claude Shannon, but no, joke aside.
Yeah.
I think it's very relevant to AI, because if you take this idea of entropy within a channel from Claude Shannon and then put it on the macro scale of a system, a very complex system like the information environment, that requires a lot of data. It requires so much amount of data. And with the way that machine learning algorithms are today and how they've proven themselves in being able to streamline the collection and preparation of just copious amounts of data, the idea of measuring entropy within a complex system like the information environment is more doable right now than it probably could have, more doable now than even 3 or 4 years ago. So my paper, that last case study, was talking about essentially entropy equals a metric for assessments in the information environment equals the benefits of AI.
Right.
And again, I think, you know, and I recommend to anyone pick John's brain on this, because he has great thought leadership. You do on Shannon, Norbert Wiener's cybernetics, John Boyd's OODA loop, Ross Ashby's, you know, interesting psychological ideas of a self-regulating system. All these things come together in certain ways. And so, that's the sum of my paper.
Right. And also mapping this back on to Kara Masick's discussion as well. Link in the show notes to her previous episode. So I don't believe I mentioned this. We're recording this on April 24th, 2024. And so she's just finishing up a PhD program at George Mason University, where she's looking at some of these challenges. But in her previous episode, she is talking about what she calls like some sort of a conglomerate measure of effectiveness. And she, I'm paraphrasing here, but I think she would agree that, it's really difficult to measure effectiveness in the information environment. But it's especially difficult if you're only reliant on one thing. Right. It's like, yes or no. Did we have an effect in whatever the measure is that you're looking at? But she promotes, you know, like more of an aggregation of measures. So like if you have a half a dozen different measures, all of which, you know, maybe tell part of the story. And if you can say, well, four of the six measures suggest that we're having some sort of a desirable effect. Well, let's just call it good. Let's just assume that we are in fact having a positive effect, because 4 of our 6 or 5 of our 6 or 7 of our 10 measures are at least pointing in the right direction. And so, you know, looking at the entropy of various different systems and the change in entropy could be one of those measures, possibly.
Yeah, I was, and let's talk about Kara real quick. I because I was able to connect to her through the Information Professionals Association, through IPA.
Yeah.
She actually, I was privileged to have her review my paper. She reviewed it. She edited it and helped
me
before it got to publication. And so I think this is what I love about IPA. I know that's a new initiative right now, creating communities of like-minded individuals, you know, or in particular domains.
Yeah.
I am a living case about that, thanks to IPA. Like she reviewed my paper and made it so much better, thanks to her thought leadership.
Yeah. Hey, awesome. Hey, I wasn't expecting you to give such a compelling firsthand account of that. But
I'm a public affairs officer.
But hey, you know, since you're on the topic, I'll go ahead and double down. You know, and absolutely. You know, so this podcast and the Information Professionals Association is all about bringing together, I mean, you mentioned, you know, multidisciplinary or interdisciplinary, you know, approach, you know, bringing together all kinds of, you know, thought leaders like you, Jose, and others to foment hard and soft power solutions to, you know, the cognitive and information problems which are bearing down on us right now. And so this is the professional community for information professionals of all stripes, you know, public affairs and media, journalists, MISO, PSYOP, cyber, electronic warfare, civil affairs. You know, I'm sure I'm leaving somebody out, and I don't intend to. But yeah, thank you for that mention for sure, Jose. And you know, your paper really is a tour de force of, you know, some various different AI related considerations that I think information professionals and decision makers should be staying abreast of. Maybe we can turn the page a little bit and talk a little bit more about some real world experiences that you've had, Jose. And I keep on referencing back to some previous episodes, but I want to mention another episode that we had with a colleague of yours, Julie Jansen, and there'll be a link in the show notes. But she mentioned to me that you guys work together on a Baltics related campaign. Do you think that you could unpack this for our audience?
Yeah, I'd love to. I really had the great privilege to work with Pistol, Lieutenant Colonel Jansen. That was her call sign. And, you know, if you ever get to work with her, you can see how she got her call sign, Pistol. She gets things quick. I mean, and she's smart as a whip. And at the height of the Ukraine crisis in 2022, she really whipped our command's IO and A-39 capabilities into shape. But the Baltic F-35 round robin campaign that she references is a textbook example of how IO and PA have to work together to be effective. And again, I'm going to harken back to General Ryder, because he said it best. Again, he said partnerships and collaborations are crucial for effective results in the information environment. And this campaign is indicative of that. So what happened was, and I'll set the stage a little bit. Most people know what happened. Ukraine got invaded. But for us at US Air Forces in Europe, we weren't necessarily surprised. And it goes back to what I brought up earlier when we were staging the information environment, really the Biden administration, saying, look at all this movement happening with the Russians. Look at what they're planning on doing it. And so I hate to say it, but we weren't surprised that the invasion happened. The administration had been, like I said, they had been leading up to it for months. And, you know, it goes back to the inoculation theory and all that stuff about disinformation that I talked about earlier. From USAFE here, we were operating at, because of that, we were operating at a frenetically high tempo, even in the fall leading up to the invasion. And if you remember, in news and in the public sphere, there were camps within the alliance that were skeptical about what we were releasing, you know, of if Putin would actually invade, despite the intelligence that we knew we had and what we were releasing. So, but when we talk about the eastern flank of the alliance, especially the Baltic states, they didn't hesitate. They knew, you know, it's going to happen. And they were especially nervous about the Russians. They're right there on the borders of their countries. So at that time, leading up to the invasion, we were doing all these air domain activities in the eastern flank. We were what are called NATO enhanced vigilance activities. So we're doing combat air patrols, enhanced air policing. We're essentially just we're throwing fighter jets up there in the air to patrol the area to secure NATO sovereignty and airspace. And at the time, we were just trying to keep the alliance collectively strong, especially in the information environment or in the public sphere of what we're talking about. And as you can imagine, on the eastern flank, they were understandably nervous. There's a shared history with the Russians. So if we think, and I think this is very important in talking about the case study, or not the case study, but this particular campaign, you got to think phenomenologically from the individual perspectives of a Latvian or a Romanian or a Pole. You know, if I'm an Estonian and I'm painfully remember the days of the former Soviet Union. If I'm a younger generation, then I remember my parents complaining all the time about the Soviet Union. The Soviet Union is bad. And now all of a sudden, here comes Russia, the vestiges of the Soviet Union, knocking down my neighbor's door, Ukraine, and violently barging in. I'm terrified. I'm scared. You know, this is a very important perspective to have from the eastern flank countries that maybe we take for granted. And at the time, within the U.S. Air Force, in Europe, you know, we had a presence in southeastern Europe from Poland down to Romania, but we didn't have a native presence up there in the Baltics with jets actually stationed up there in Lithuania, Latvia, and Estonia. So for us, we understood that assuring the governments and the populations on the eastern flank of NATO is just constant imperative, especially at the heels, you know, or well, now that you know, Russia invaded, right? But even before, but after Russia invaded, they wanted assurance. They were nervous. And in terms of public communications in the information environment, the president and the National Security Council were very deliberate. They kind of locked down everything from the top down. And that makes absolute sense, right? You're dealing with nation states and geopolitics. You know, I'm just a random Air Force person, right? You got to stay in your lane. But, you know, there's a friction point too, because we also want to assure our allies. We didn't have assets up there in the Baltics. So it begs the question, all things considered, what could we do within U.S. Air Forces in Europe and really U.S. EUCOM, U.S. European Command, to assure our allies with communication tightly controlled and without actual native assets up there in the Baltics. So our answer to reference Pistol's campaign was, long story short, we could assure our allies by flying fifth generation aircraft, F-35s with a KC-135 tanker across prominent landmarks in the Baltics to communicate a message. And you know, a lot of the glamour was with the F-35s, obviously. But, you know, there was also the component of the tanker, because it communicated, you know, the idea that, you know, we may not have native assets up there, but the U.S. Air Force can be anywhere, anytime, at a moment's notice, mm-hmm. without hesitation. And this goes back, I think, to Colonel Jansen's outstanding discussion here on the Cognitive Crucible about signature management as this process of altering, concealing, revealing observables to send a message, because that's exactly what we did. We sent a message by sending iron up there to assure our NATO allies.
Right.
And
she definitely makes that point as well. It's like everything sends a message, you know, a message doesn't have to be something written on a piece of paper or a tweet or, you know, something that comes across the computer, but every physical activity in the real world is communicating and sending a message. And I think that's you're referring to sending a message by, you know, having planes in the air at an appropriate place and time sends a message.
Yeah, I mean, even no message is a message, you know. Everything's a message.
Yeah,
you know.
Right.
The last thing I'll hit on this campaign, because I think this was the most novel part, and I think the most important part, especially if we go into this new age of generative AI and in the information environment. So we had actually attempted to do this kind of approach with F-35 aircraft 3 prior occasions, and we missed the mark, I think, is the short answer. And the reasons, you know, varied. You know, it was either because the F-35 pilots canceled the sortie and didn't tell us, you know, the people were trying to communicate, right? Or they didn't go below cloud coverage. And so I have a photographer there from the U.S. Embassy in Latvia, like, where's the F-35? I mean, how am I going to communicate this? You know, and this is akin to that old philosophical conundrum, you know, if a tree falls in a forest and no ears are there to hear it, does it make a sound? In a sense, the answer is like no, you know, and in these 3 prior times, the task board, the concept of operations, they were all crafted and created and driven by operators, you know, pilots, kinetic operators. And we were all frustrated because we were failing. And then something really unique happened and really set a precedent. What was wholly unique of this final successful F-35 Baltic round robin was that the concept of operations, the task board, the directing of iron, of pilots to go do something, was crafted by an operator in the information environment, by a public affairs officer, by an IO person. So rather than, you know...
Nailed it.
Yeah, that was kind of mind-blowing. And I think to the kudos of the operators, they understood, like, we needed to do something different. And in a way, indulged us. They were like, okay, well, you know, you can figure it out and you can assure that we're going after the 4 stars direction to assure the Baltics. We'll do what you tell us to do, but you have to succeed. You know, you have that pressure, you know, and we did. And so rather, long story short, it was a PA and IO, 39 Colonel Jameson, everyone in, you know, operators in the information environment, we created the operation itself. It wasn't tied into some previous sortie or training exercise. We made the activity of flying 5th generation aircraft as a non-kinetic effect operation to achieve results. And that was, I think that's the short end of that case, of that campaign. It was success. And it set a precedent. We've experimented with this model, you know, in the past 2 years, I think most successfully with our bomber task forces that come out here to Europe every so often to deter and assure, you know, we follow the same model and we're telling bombers essentially where they need to go. And that's the coolest thing as you know, information professional, you know, professional communicator. You know, we're telling the pilots, you need to go over there if you want to deter and assure, you know, and you know, if you think about it, really, again, philosophically, is deterrence a kinetic achievement or is it really a non-kinetic achievement? You know, again, it goes back to that tree in the forest thing. Someone, a receiver, has to be there to hear it for it to make a sound. Otherwise, it's just sound waves floating in the air. And if no one sees or hears a B-52 flying over Europe and no one knows about it, is it actually deterring anything? And I think that's the importance of our job as operators of the information environment. You know, we have a significance as equivalent to those operators who delivered kinetic results, especially if we can prevent war from happening. That's, I think, always a huge win.
Yeah, no, that's a great case study that really, you know, brings together a number of different requirements working across staff function, teamwork aspect, you know, understanding that everything has an effect, and you know, really bringing all that together, powerful case study. Thanks for unpacking all of that. Wow. Well, this has been dynamite, Jose. We could keep going on and on, I'm sure, but let's start closing things out, or shifting a little bit. So let's go into a lightning round. So maybe like 30 seconds or so per response, and then we'll start wrapping things up. So lightning round. First lightning round. The future of AI.
Yeah. So today's AI is the least capable AI of tomorrow. I think that's the mind blowing part. I mean, today's AI is the Windows 98 of tomorrow. Just expect. I think look for innovations in computation power. That's the biggest limiting factor, especially in terms of neuromorphic and quantum computing. That's going to be a game changer for AI.
Okay. No, that's good. That's a good one. Today's AI is like Windows 98. That's awesome. Okay. Second lightning round. Google Gemini versus OpenAI versus Claude Shannon versus Meta's Llama. Maybe I got the, it's not Claude Shannon. It's just Claude.
Yeah.
Right? Okay. So
Claude, Anthropic's AI model. I think.
Okay. Comparing all those.
Yeah. So I think I'll keep it simple with this, because I think this is goes back to the first lightning round question. Llama 3. So Meta released their Llama 3 model, large language model competitor to ChatGPT earlier this week, their latest advancement. And it's disrupting everything. I mean, and when I sent you those, when my feedback on some ideas for the lightning round, my question was already outdated, because that was Llama 3 hadn't come out. So long story short, Gemini, Google has the data, OpenAI has the innovation in terms of algorithms and large language models. Meta's Llama is open source, so anyone can get it. And Anthropic, they believe in that constitutional AI stuff, how realistic that is. I don't know. I tend to be a cynic, but they all have their own virtues and their own values. And it'll be interesting to see who's going to come out on top.
Right. Right. Okay. And next lightning round, Claude Shannon.
I'm just going to say, read the book.
Okay. Fair enough.
Yeah.
At last lightning round. Okay. Your call sign. Call sign Houdini. What's up with that?
Oh yeah, shoot. Yeah. So, the short, simple thing, I got that call sign from an F-16 pilot, because I'm able to make magic happen, just glitter some, throw some glitter or whatever. And also because I'm a hothead, and there's a whole story. You have to buy me a beer. It's the only way I tell it.
Okay. All right. Fair enough. All right. So, research. So there's obviously a whole bunch of things that students can take a look at related to the kinds of things that you've been working on, Jose. What are some fruitful research questions that you think somebody might take a crack at?
Yeah, so I think further research on inoculation theory, I think there's a lot of benefits there in terms of the social sciences. In the military context, I mean, to Kara's the point, I mean, there's so much potential there in trying to discover ways to measure the information environment in a national security context. If you're interested in AI, you got to start off with that seminal paper that came out in 2017 by those Google researchers called Attention is All You Need. You have to read that. It's almost akin to Newton's Principia or even Einstein's relativity, at least in terms of history. That's what made ChatGPT possible with the transformer technology. So go study that, and you will already be a leg up on a whole bunch of AI research.
All right. Excellent. And we'll have a link to that paper. And lastly, Jose, do you have any book suggestions or other online resource suggestions that interested audience members might check out?
Yeah, I have two good book recommendations. The first one is called AI 2041, 10 Visions for Our Future. And it's written by this former Google technologist called Kai-Fu Lee and a science fiction writer, Shen Qifan. And I'm a huge advocate, obviously, as a PA, of using story to educate. And what I really liked about this book is that it gave short stories to explain very complex ideas in artificial intelligence, deep neural networks, deep learning, all that stuff. So you get a fun read and then you get the technical analysis. My second book recommendation, obviously, is Claude Shannon. there's this great biography that came out recently on him called A Mind at Play, How Claude Shannon Invented the Information Age by Jimmy Soney and Rob Goodman. I think every information warfare professional or anyone in this space should know Claude Shannon and try to read his Magna Carta of the Information Age, the Mathematical Theory of Communication, or at least pretend like you can read through it. You know, I barely could read through it.
Right.
But it's so seminal to what we do and still so applicable. And learning about the man is even more rewarding.
Right. 100% on all that. And, you know, I don't normally do this, but there is one other book that I, or booklet that people I think should check out. And hang on a second. I've got to look up the exact title, but it has to do with communications in the social sciences. Let's see. We'll trim some of this down a little bit here, but fantastic. It's a little like booklet by a cybernetics researcher named Klaus Krippendorf called Information Theory, Structural Models for Qualitative Data. And in this little booklet, it's very dense, it's very technical, but he goes into great detail about, you know, communication channels, and especially for the social sciences. So I would also suggest that for our audience, if you are interested in some really geeky deep dive stuff into information theory and communications theory and entropy and communication channels and all this kinds of stuff, we'll have a link to that in the show notes as well. So with that, Jose Davis, thank you so much for what you're doing and what you're studying, and for being a guest on the Cognitive Crucible.
Thank you, John. Thank you for having me. I love being here, and I always love listening to Cognitive Crucible.
The Cognitive Crucible is the only podcast dedicated to increasing interdisciplinary collaboration between information operations practitioners, scholars, and policymakers. To find out more about the Information Professionals Association, visit us at information-professionals.org. Please support our podcast by giving us a 5-star rating and leaving a review.